Webinar session, Know Your Surroundings. Learn to identify plants and animals using your phone. ఈ సెషన్ కి ఆర్పిగా శ్రీ రఫీక్ షేక్ గారు వ్యవహరిస్తారు. రఫీక్ షేక్ గారు టాటా ఇన్స్టిట్యూట్ ఆఫ్ సోషల్ సైన్స్ నందలి సెంటర్ ఫర్ ఎడ్యుకేషన్ ఇన్నోవేషన్ అండ్ యాక్షన్ రీసెర్చ్ విభాగం నందు పనిచేయుచున్నారు. అలాగే రఫీక్ గారు హోమీ బాబా సెంటర్ ఫర్ సైన్స్ ఎడ్యుకేషన్ నుండి పిహెచ్డి కూడా చేయుచున్నారు. మరియు కనెక్టెడ్ లెర్నింగ్ ఇనిషియేటివ్ నందు కూడా అసోసియేట్ అయి ఉన్నారు. రఫీక్ గారితో పాటు ఈరోజు మనకు ప్యానెల్ మెంబర్గా డాక్టర్ రవీందర్ రెడ్డి గారు, ప్రిన్సిపల్ డైట్ ఆదిలాబాద్ గారు, అలాగే శ్రీ లియాఖత్ అలీ, లెక్చరర్ సిటిఈ మహబూబ్ నగర్, మరియు శ్రీ ఎం సిపి మాధవి గారు ఎస్సిఆర్టి. వీరితో పాటు సాంకేతిక సహాయకులుగా బొమ్మయ్య గారు వ్యవహరిస్తారు. నౌ ఐ రిక్వెస్ట్ రఫీక్ గారు, ప్లీజ్ టేక్ వెబినార్ సెషన్. థ్యాంక్ యూ.
Namaskar. Thank you so much, sir, for introducing me. So we will start. I will share my screen and we will immediately proceed to the webinar. I hope I'm audible and visible clearly.
Yeah.
Okay. Okay, so when we teach science in a classroom, we all have to use examples of various plants, animals, and microorganisms. And then in our textbooks also, there are a lot of examples given. But if you consider India as a country and then one textbook, let's say NCERT designs a textbook for science education and it includes some examples of plants and animals. Similarly, states also. Each state has its own textbook, science textbook, and there are examples given in. But India is such a big country that even if, let's say, science textbook tries to include examples of local plants and animal, it is not possible to include every child's surrounding. And then what happens is that it becomes difficult for students to connect what they study in their classrooms, in their textbooks, to what they see in their real life. So this dichotomy creates problem in learning. So children see something in their home, in their surroundings, but they learn something else in their textbook. When I say something else, it's not the concepts are the same if they even study what is in their surrounding, but the examples. So for example, there is in Chhattisgarh textbook, there is in the evolution and adaption chapter, there is a example of a fish which doesn't have eyes because that fish evolved in a cave for thousands of years. But that is very difficult to understand because children don't have that experience. Even children from Chhattisgarh haven't seen that fish. it's a good example, it's a great example of explaining evolution, but there are hundreds of examples just around our houses and schools and villages and cities, which you can use, where children can actually observe them. So in this webinar, what we are going to do is just two simple things. We are going to learn how to identify the plants and animals in our surrounding. So we as a teacher, teacher students, or even we as a learner, we actually see so many things in your home, in your schools, in your surroundings. But for us, it is very difficult to identify them. When I say identify, I mean, we might know their common names, local names, which generally we use, but we don't know their scientific name. And if we don't know their scientific name, then it is difficult to then take that common name and try to connect it with the concepts which are being taught in school, in science education, in science textbook. That's why if we want to take an example from local surrounding and use instead of a given example or along with that example, then we need to know its scientific name. We need to know few things about it. So in this webinar today, we are going to do that. We are going to do two simple things. One, how to identify a plant or animal in your surrounding. And second, what we are going to do is, on internet, you cannot trust everything. Internet is full of information. And as you are aware, I mean, you all are aware, we all talk about fake news and all, but fake information or misleading information, so many things are there. Or even our interpretation or our search can be misleading. So we also want to know how to verify the information which we have found about identified plant or animal. So just two simple things: how to use your phone to identify a plant or animal, and how to verify that information. Just two tasks.
Rafiq, hello. I'm sorry to interrupt, but people are not able to look at your screen. It's very small.
What can we do? I'll try to rotate my screen. Just a minute. Okay, how about now? Now, Shashank?
It's okay.
It's okay now?
It's okay, go ahead.
Okay. So, let's start. So, today, there are many apps, but today we are going to use this one app. And at the end, I will tell you the other alternative apps you can use for this purpose. So I just wanted to give some background about how this app works. So basically, Google Lens, or let's start first with installing. While you are installing, then we can talk about it. Because this is a hands-on workshop, what I want you to do is, on your phone, go to the Play Store, or if you have an iPhone, the App Store, and then install this app. It will take, depending upon your internet speed, a few seconds to a minute. So while you are installing this app, I will give you a brief idea about what this app does. So now, the internet, this app uses internet, and it uses a data bank of plants and animals and their photos. So what this app does is, it uses artificial intelligence to analyze the photo you upload, and then it narrows down your search and then it gives you three options. Whatever it thinks that photo you have uploaded looks like. Okay, so basically it's nothing but an AI, artificial intelligence system, which goes through millions of photos and identifies some similar looking photos. And then because it is doing in databases of scientific photos, it also gives you names associated with it. Okay, so let me know when you have you are done with the your installation. Basically, you have to go to App Store. Go to search and look for Google Lens. And then this is the app. Just click on install and it will start installing. Shashank, how long we should wait?
Yes, or should we? You go ahead.
They will keep installing, right?
Yes. Then there are.
Yeah. And so I will now give an example. So this is a photo I took. I think I was with Shashank when I took this photo. So now let's say we don't know what is the name of this plant. You must have seen this plant in your gardens, or it maybe you have at your home. So how do we find out its name? So what I will do is I will just take so I have this photo with me. It's in my gallery. So here it is. This is the photo. Okay. So what you have to do is just go to the photo in your phone. You can directly also do, but because right now I'm inside my house and I'm doing from inside. Otherwise, I can use Google Lens. Instead of taking, I can directly just view the plant or animal I want to identify and then do it. But right now what I'm doing is I have already taken a photo. So I will just open this photo into the Google Lens app. Okay. So I'm opening it. So now it is trying to search the database and then it identified it as purple heart. So when the app is very sure, it will not give you any options. It will directly tell you what it is. So in this case, it is correct. It is actually purple a plant called purple heart. Okay. So now when it identifies, it gives you direct link to Wikipedia. Can you see here at the bottom, there is a blue link for Wikipedia. If I click on that link, so it will take me to the Wikipedia page for the plant. Okay. So this is its scientific name. Its scientific name is Trescantia pallida. It is from family Pomelinaceae. K kingdom, plantain, all other things. It also gives me other related searches. For example, there is a link from gardenia.net. There's a link from vmastergarden.org. There are some videos and all this. Okay. So now, how do I confirm that the identification is correct? So what we have to do is basically just go to Wikipedia or any other website, and then it is better if you are close to the plant. What you need to do is you need to look at the description. The description of the plant and description written on some website or some authentic website or Wikipedia or something like that, does it matches? So for example, does it has sterile three pelleted flowers of white or pink or purple? So the photo I took was of white. So it either has white flower, pink flower or purple flower. Okay. Then also you need to check photos of its leaves, its flowers, all other things. So you can, using all this information, you need to see if it actually matches with the plant you are observing and information you are reading on the internet. Okay. Okay. So now, this was first example. Let's go to second example. So can you see what this is? I think, Shashank, can they reply?
It's streaming live on YouTube, Rafi, I think.
Okay, no problem. So this is these big grains you see, these are rice grains. So in your house, whoever has rice, you must have seen these really small insects in your the container in which you keep your rice. It is almost impossible to miss this insect. At some point of time, you must have seen this insect in your rice. So let's say we want to identify this insect. So what you have to do is you have to do the same thing. Just go to the gallery. And I have a photo of the insect. Here it is. Okay. So same thing. The procedure is same. That was a plant. Now this is an animal. So for this also, what you have to do is just open this into Lens, Google Lens. Then it will do its search. Now here it is not very sure about it. Okay, that's why it gave three options. Either it is maize weevil, wheat weevil, or rice weevil. Okay, now based on the information we have, that is, we found this in rice, so we can say that this is a rice weevil. Okay, here also it gives lot of, at the end, lot of photos which are very similar to the photo we have. So I will then choose based on my information, background information I have, I will choose the rice weevil option. Okay. Now I will also check if it matches with my photo. Okay. So like my photo, it has legs, three pairs of legs. It also has two antennas near mouth. The body structure is also very same, and size also looks almost So if you compare with the rice grain, it looks correct. So then what I will do is, I will go to Wikipedia again by just clicking this small link here. Or the other option is, I can search. There is a just below rice bevel, there is a Google search option. So I will click on Google search, and it will do a rice bevel Google search for me. Okay, now I can find about what is its scientific name. So its scientific name is Psittophilus oryzae. Okay, and then rice bevel is stored, generally it is found in stored product. Okay, stored products such as wheat, rice or maize. Then if I go down, I will find lot of information about it. So here is a good article. What is a bevel and how did that bug get in my food? There are some scientific article also, rice bevel. So now that I'm here, I will also address the other question that I'm showing you how to verify if our identification is correct or not, and also how to verify whether the information we are reading is authentic or not. So there are some keys to it. One is, we need to see the site on which the information is. So this is a Wikipedia. Wikipedia is reasonably accurate. You cannot say that it's 100% accurate, but it is very close. Because it's a community-driven project, sometimes some mistakes do happen, but mostly you can trust the information on Wikipedia. Then there are these sites which are authentic, and then they are dedicated to this kind of thing. So for example, bug spray. Their entire it's a commercial website. They sell products against this kind of bugs. So you can trust this one. Then there are some websites which are basically educational websites. So you can identify those websites with the end domain name. No? So .edu generally education related websites. So for example, Tata Institute has a website called tis.edu. TFR has a website called tfr.res.in. So that is Research Institute, res.in. Or then there are websites called .gov. Those are government websites. So you can trust the websites which are about research labs, educational institutes, universities, and government organizations, or some known non-governmental bodies with some authentic record or background. So you can search, you can be sure that these organization won't actually put misleading information. We cannot be sure about the individual bloggers or individual users who write, because they don't have that backing behind them. Still, you can use it as a lead, but you cannot be very sure about it. Okay, let's go back to the presentation. Okay, so these are the two examples I wanted to give of a plant and an animal. So while doing that, we also discussed how to verify. How to verify? Basically, you need to check your plant or animal and check whether it matches its description, its photos, matches with the what you are observing in your surrounding. So if you are observing the purple heart plant, you need to check how does flower look, what are the possible colors of the flower, structure of the flower, whether it is same number of petals, same number of sepal, the size of flower, then size of the plant, shape of the leaves, all these things. In case of animal, you need to see its origin. Where did you find the animal? What is its size? What is the color? What is the shape? How many legs, tentacles? So whatever possible things you can see in photo, and whether these are matching with it. And then the second part of our verification is the source of the information. So it should be government organization, educational institutes, universities, research institutes, or some known non-governmental bodies such as Wikipedia or some companies who work in this. So you can trust those websites and information on that website. Okay, so now we will come back to our science education question. So why do we want to identify plants and animals in our surrounding? Because, so this is really important. There are two aspects to it. One, how does this app help us and till where? And then why that identification, or how that identification is useful in our education. So first we will try to understand how this app helps. So for that we need to understand something called binomial nomenclature. So most of you who have science background will be aware that we follow a system of naming living organisms, plants, animal, microorganisms, everything. The system is that it generally has two names. The first name is of a genus, and the second name is of the species. So that's the unique name given to that particular species of plant or animal. And then there is a classification. It is a top-down approach. So basically, the species is the smallest unit of plant or animal who can interbreed. Then a bigger group of such similar animals is genus. Then even the bigger group is family. That way it goes family, order, class, phylum, and kingdom. So in the old days when there were no smartphones, the task of identifying a plant or animal is very difficult. Only botanist or zoologist or microbiologist could do it, because you need a lot of experience and a protocol to identify a plant or animal. So what they generally used to do is top-down approach. So whether it is a plant, so based on that, if it is a plant, it will be in kingdom Plantae, or if it is animal, then it will be in kingdom animal. Then you come down to phylum. So then whether it has a backbone or not, depending upon that, it will be decided which phylum it will go. Then, so this is the example I'm giving, how, let's say, if a zoologist try to identify human being. So human being can move around. So that means it's not a plant, it's a animal. So then it will be kingdom animals. Then you come to whether it has a backbone. Humans have backbone, so it's a chordates. Then come to the class. So it has a fur on hair and milk glands. That means it's mammals. Then come to order. Mammals with collarbone and grasping fingers. So humans have collarbone and humans have grasping fingers. Then it's a primates. Then come to family. So primates with the relative fat facets and three-dimensional division. So no other hominid is alive other than human beings. So I think we can clearly say that it's a hominid. And then genus is Homo, and then that is based on posture, and then finally the species is based on high forehead and thin skull bones. So we use some characteristic to keep narrow it down till we come to species. So this is more or less this is the step generally for field biologist or field field botanist follow. But what has happened now due to the technology, now it is possible that people like us who don't have background in biology, meaning expertise in biology and zoology, who are science educator or science education researcher or enthusiast or children, can also identify. So we can use apps like these, and what these apps do is they cut down the first five categories: kingdom, phylum, class, order, and family. So they directly bring you till family option, sometimes till genus, and sometimes directly till species. So in the case of purple heart, you saw it directly told us the species name. Sometimes it's not sure, so it tells us the genus. Family name. So it actually reduces our work enormously. Then what it remains is a simple mismatching. We just have to simply match the patterns, characteristic of what you are looking at it and what is there, and then identify it. So it actually cuts down. The app uses a database to cut down almost 70% of our work. Okay, so now I want you to do an exercise. Shashank, they'll be able to do an exercise?
Yeah, but I am not sure whether they'll be able to respond.
Let's see how many, even if few of them can do it, it'll be good enough that at least they have understood. Should we try?
Yes, yes, yes. Please go ahead.
Yeah. Okay. So those who now have installed Google Lens, just take screenshot of this photo, which you are seeing at in your screen. You know how to take screenshot. Depending upon what phone you have various shortcuts. So for example, in my phone, I need to just use my three fingers, touch, and just make a gesture. Just I have to pull down and it will take screenshot. When you take screenshot, please open it in your Google Lens and tell, maybe in the comments, can they write in comments?
Yes, yes.
So those who are in Zoom, I think those who are on YouTube, I don't know how, but those who are on Zoom can write in their comment what is the name of this. So what is the name you are getting from using Google Lens? Some of you might already know its name. Still, you try. Just take a screenshot, open it in your, go to the gallery and open it in Google Lens.
We have received a few answers, both you. We have started to receive answers.
Okay, okay, good.
Shall I read out a few answers, Rafiq?
In comment, did somebody reply?
Yes, yes.
Okay, please read out.
So, most of them have said purple passion flower. And one on Zoom, one has said passiflora. One has said purple passion flower or maypop or blue passion flower. Passiflora incarnata.
Yeah, so these are the common name. Can you write the at least genus, if even if you are not sure about species name, what is the genus name? Passion flower is a common name. What is the scientific genus and species name? Even if you are not sure about species name, that is fine. Just genus name is also enough. Did somebody reply?
They're saying genus as Passiflora.
Correct.
Passiflora incarnata, some has given reply.
Yeah, correct. So you got the idea? Okay, now let's go to example 2. Okay, now try this one. This is one of my favorite plant. I have taken this photo outside my house. And our Mumbai TIS campus also has three trees. Sorry.
We received
cannonball tree. You reply.
Correct. This is a cannonball tree. And scientific name?
One has said sal tree.
Okay, that might be a common name, but that's why we need to know scientific name. There can be many common names.
Charopita genensis. Somebody replied.
Correct. So that is how. So this is a really interesting plant. Through my exercise, I learned about this plant. And then I found out that this plant has a really interesting flower. So you can see the flower has pink or pinkish petals. And then there are two kinds of anthers here. One is which are protruding out with pink with the yellowish tip. And that the other one is all faint yellow. So it also has two kinds of pollens. So very few, it's rare, extremely rare. Very few plants have two types of pollens in just one flower. So it has one set of pollen, which are fertile, meaning they go and fertilize with the egg. And then there is another set of pollens. Nobody knows their role. So they are called fodder pollen. So current scientific community's current guess is that it might be to attract pollinators, and it acts as fodder, meaning food for them. But it's a interesting question to ask is that why would a plant have a different set of pollen to pollinators use as a feeder or food. There are so many other generally plants have secretions, sweet or the bright colors to attract. So this one already has a bright color. Then why does it has two sets of pollen? So that's a really interesting thing about it. Okay, these were two plants. We'll do one just last animal. So which one? I think wait. Let's do this one. Do we have time to do two, or I should do just one?
We can do two.
Okay. Let's do this one first. So you must have seen, I mean, we all see so many butterflies, right? But we all call them just butterflies, a big category. So this can help us actually make sense of the variety of butterfly we see in our gardens, schools. But taking photo of butterfly is very difficult.
Somebody responded as Thalicada.
Okay. Can you read it again?
Thalicada. Thalicada.
Okay. Got it. Any more response?
One says Ropa Lokreya. Ropa Lokreya. ROPALOCREA.
Let's wait for a few more responses.
Somebody responded as Thalicada maesius.
Okay. So now that there is some confusion and there is a disagreement, we will do this, use it as a demonstration to see how to solve this kind of a confusion. So I'll just go to my gallery and then I'll open this in my Google Lens app. Okay. So now, actually, in this case, it is very sure that it is Thalicada. But what is Thalicada? Thalicada, is it a genus name, or it is actually telling us still species name? Right, it is a genus name, so it is not sure about the species part. So it is taking us till the genus level, and for our purpose that is also good enough. Species generally, there are really subtle differences between different species of the same genus. Okay. So what is its common name? We can also find out its common name. So Thalicada, I can just search in Telugu. What is it called? Talismanda. Is it correct? I don't know. In English, it is called red period. That I know. Anyway, so basically, till genus level is also good for us. Okay, this is the last one. We'll do it very fast. Then we also have to discuss about how to use it in the classroom. So this photo I had taken in our Mumbai TIS campus. This is one of the prettiest organism I have seen. So just do this one. Any reply?
No, no. White marked tussock moth, brown tussock
moth. Correct. So it's a caterpillar of white tussock moth. So it is right, one part of its life cycle is like this. And then in other part of its life cycle, it will turn into a butterfly. It will turn into a moth. Moth is very similar to butterfly. It doesn't have that many colors, but it's the overall structure is very similar to butterfly. Okay. Let's come to this part. So what are the precautions we should take while using this app? So one obvious precaution is the photos can be misleading. Meaning when we take photos and this app is using a photo recognition algorithm, it can actually sometimes get really confusing. So for example, this is the photo. They look really big, but these are, what is it called? Mustard seeds. These are extremely small mustard seeds, but I have taken with some lens these photos. Sometimes we take photo and then because of the camera effect and all, we get some color, or we sometimes in photo, it looks like something else. So what happens is, in that case, the app can give you extremely misleading identification. You can take a photo of a plant and it looks like some other color, some animal or something like that. And then it will tell you that maybe it is that animal. So that has happened with me many times. That's why we need to be very sure, very clear about, very careful when we are taking photo. And we need to do the second step, that verification is very important. So we need to understand that these kind of apps don't identify completely. What they do is they narrow down your search. They cut off your 70% of your task, your work, but you still have to do your identification. So you can use it to as an assistive technology, as a supportive technology in your identification. But still you have to do some matching, some pattern matching exercise. There are many similar apps. Okay,
I just give an example of Google Lens because it can be used for both plants and animals. But there are apps which are specifically dedicated to one part, either just for plant or just for animal or just for birds or just for butterflies, like that. Okay. So, for example, Plant Snap is just for plants. Then this Free Europe is for bugs. Then there is this Bio Guide. Then there is a Flora Recognition. There are various apps. All of these apps you can try. One of my favorite is Picture This. Till now it was free, but recently they have changed it to pay. Now it is you have to pay to use this app. But that's also a really good app to identify plants. So all these apps are available on your phone, meaning you can install them. Most of them are free and then use for various purposes. Okay, so now I wanted to, before I end, I wanted to talk about why do we need to identify and how do we use it in our classroom? So there is a lot of research in science education research community that the problem why children are not interested in science or don't enjoy science or having difficulty in learning science is because of the disconnect between the natural world they see around them and the concepts and examples they read in the textbook. So if you think that if you want children to be excited and interested, then the teacher can actually just ask them to explore their surroundings. Okay. And then teacher himself or herself also needs to do the same exercise. If teacher knows about plants and animals which are there in their students' surrounding, and when he's teaching, he can always bring an example from children's surrounding to talk about any concepts. Okay, so for example, let's say a teacher is teaching food cycle. Okay, the ecosystem, the producers, primary consumers, secondary consumer, tertiary consumer, and decomposers. So in the textbook, there are examples of examples from jungle, where there is a rabbit and there is a grass rabbit and, or snake and hawk and tiger and then microorganisms and like. So that is how the energy is flowing. But many children, for example, those who are living in the city, may have not seen all these animals. But if you take an example from inside your school campus or from your houses, they may understand. They may tell you if you ask them to observe. So, for example, this example I gave, rice weevil. Okay. So, you need to, you can ask them to find out what does rice weevil eats. Is there, how do they die? What happens? Do other insects or animals inside our house eat them? Then what happens to that? So basically you can just trace what is the food source of these animals and who eats them or how do they die. And then you can actually create a food cycle inside a house, because our houses are nothing but working ecosystems, right? We are also part of that ecosystem. Or inside school, you have plants, a lot of insects living on them. There are other animals eating them. So all you need to do is just identify examples of life cycles from energy cycles from your campus, your schools. And then it will solve that problem of disconnect. They will think, they will know that actually what we are learning is there. It's in your house. We are learning about actual real things. Okay. So yeah, that's it I wanted to say. If there are questions, we can take.
Rafiq Garu, ee roju webinar lo.
Sorry?
Rafiq Garu, ee roju webinar lo mana parisarallo undetatuvanti plants and animals ni Google Lens app ఉపయోగించి ఏ విధంగా గుర్తించాలి మరి సరి అయినటువంటి సమాచారమా కాదా అనేది ఏ విధంగా తెలుసుకోవాలనే విషయాన్ని చక్కగా వివరించారు. అంతేకాకుండా వ్యూవర్స్ కూడా రఫీక్ గారు అడిగిన ప్రశ్నలకు ఇమ్మీడియట్ గా గూగుల్ లెన్స్ ఉపయోగించి వారికి కూడా వారు ఇచ్చినటువంటి ప్రశ్నలకు తొందరగా సమాధానం చెప్పడం జరిగింది. ప్యానలిస్ట్ రవీందర్ రెడ్డి గారు, ఏమైనా క్వశ్చన్స్ ఉన్నాయా?
సో వెరీ గుడ్ ప్రెజెంటేషన్ సార్, గుడ్ ప్రెజెంటేషన్ రఫీక్ సార్. You have explained how to identify the plants and animals in the surroundings with the help of a Google Lens. It is very useful to the student teachers. I want to mention in our area we find Parthenium hyperformus is a weed, Vayari Bama Anantamo. Due to its pollens, many students don't know how about this type of class may help to search different plants and animals, their scientific names, family and benefits and problems. So you have clearly mentioned the similar apps given by the by you will be very useful to the student teachers.
Yes.
Questions, sir?
Yeah. Somebody asked, sir, does this application work in iOS 12?
Yes. This app works. This app, and even if this app doesn't work, there are many alternative apps which will there be in. But the Google Lens definitely works in iOS.
So whether they are there in similar apps you have shown in the on the screen.
Correct. So I will share my slides. Shashank can send the list.
So similar apps you have shown one slide.
Correct.
Okay. That may be available in that similar apps slide.
Yeah.
Okay, thank you.
Okay, Liyakathali garu mee daggara prashna unte adagandi please. Liyakathali garu. Okay, Madhavi madam please.
Good morning everyone. First of all I would like to thank Mr. Rafiq Sheikh for conducting interesting and interactive sessions, sir. You have explained excellently and touching all the corners. There is not much left to ask, but still I would like to ask this question, sir. Sir, yeah. Can you please explain briefly its usefulness in conservation of plants and animals, sir?
Oh, that's a really nice question. Yeah, thank you for asking this question. Actually, I was only focusing on education part, but as your question pointed out, see, it is very important for conservation that we know our surrounding. The first part comes is identification. Once we know what plants and animals are around us, then we can find out their threat level. So various scientific bodies and organizations have put up this list where they list the plants and animals which are under threat, which might get extinct. So if you know the plant we observe in our school or village or somewhere and it is under threat plant, then we can take effort to actually conserve that plant. The second part is that if we also are in, if we know the diversity around us, we are aware of diversity around us, then only we can take step to so that we don't actually disturb that diversity. If we think there is just one butterfly in our we can call all butterflies as a butterfly and we are not worried about their minute differences, the diversity, then we might cut various plants, or we might, when we are planting plants, generally what these gardeners and all do for beautification, they just plant same type of plant in a garden. But that is not a good step for conservation, because the plants, butterflies, I'm just taking a butterfly as an example. Butterfly are very specific about their host plant. They have two host plants. One is for feeding and second one is for reproduction, laying eggs. Okay, so if those plants are not there, the butterflies won't come. So we need to plant variety of plants if, let's say, we want to conserve butterflies. Similarly, for plants also, the kind of activities we do, some of them can be very harmful. And then some plant cannot grow due to our activities or some chemicals we are throwing, or some particular animal is, there are a lot of, let's say, one particular type of insects there in that area, and they will eat all the seedlings of that particular plant and it will not grow. So this is a complex chain, and that diversity is coming through that complex interaction. If we disturb one of these link, then entire biodiversity gets disturbed. So to avoid that, we need to identify a plant and animal, and then we also need to study. So we cannot study entire cycles on our own. Even if you just identify and then look for information, then we'll understand their entire cycle. What do they eat, from where the energy gets, who are their predators, and things like that. So then it becomes very easy for us to take actions.
Thank you, Rafiq Sheikh Garu. Panel members, Ravindra Reddy Garu, Liaquat Ali
Garu. Sir, namaste. I am Liaquat Ali. Hello, sir.
Okay.
Sir, I have some questions. I have some problem here. Now it is set right. I have some problems, some questions to ask from the student side. Sir, shall I ask, sir?
Yeah, okay. Please go
ahead. Shall I ask? Yes, sir. Sir, one of the student, Mr. Iqbal, has asked, should this Google Lens give accurate result?
Yeah, no. We have to verify.
And another student also saying that it is giving related images rather than the correct image. So that's why verification is very important, is it not, sir?
Exactly. It just narrows down our search, but finally we have to do it.
So another thing, sir, just now you said that while classifying the animals or plants, you said that some of the taxons we can leave, and from the genus and from family genus we can identify. But it is the duty of the experienced botanist or zoologist who can exactly identify the plant or animal. But at our level, without following any protocol, how can we identify, sir?
Yeah. So this is a good question. So basically, the plant or the botanist or zoologist, now with this tool, their job comes at the species level identification. Till species, it is now possible to use this kind of app for identification, because the differences at the genus level are good enough that you can distinguish from one genus to another genus with the help of artificial intelligence. But the species level identification is not easy thing to do. So can only be done by an expert.
By the expert. So final identification is by the expert. It has to be established by the expert. Sir, another thing, sir, another question. So you said that while verifying, there are several websites are there and where we can verify the things. But specific website, for example, just now you see this rice weevil. So it is related to entomology. So is there any authentic entomology website or authentic zoological websites or botanical websites? So if such type of references are given, I think it may be good, sir.
Yeah, this is a nice question. So actually, when you start using this app and keep doing this exercise, slowly you discover that there are really good catalogs.
Yeah.
So for example, if you want to identify butterflies, there are really good authentic websites of all the information about butterflies there. Okay. So I can maybe, I am interested in birds. So I know such catalogs about birds. Then I'm also interested in plants. So I know such catalogs of birds. I'm interested in pollens. So I know such catalogs of pollens. So there are these really good databases, which are authentic because they are done by researchers. You can actually find everything, their background information, because from where you can find out whether it is authentic or not. For example, in India, NCBS has a really good database. NCBS is in Bangalore. It's a government, central government institute. So there are such databases. Maybe I can send a list of such websites.
Okay, sir. Better you send the list, sir. It may be useful for the trainees. Right, sir. Thank you, sir. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Rafiq Garu. Repati webinar session pedagogy of science pen untundi tappakunda chatrobhayajayalandaru dinni sadvinayam cheskovalsindiga korutunnam right.